Okay, looks like I've got vocal. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, etc. I'm starting way early today for a very simple reason. I'm like you. It's time for fall free days, and I know that many of you probably will not, maybe you'll listen to it tonight or whatever. I don't know. And I appreciate and understand that you're young people and being cooped up in a classroom on a beautiful day like today would absolutely drive me stark raving mad too. So I'm doing this. This is a virtual Wednesday broadcast. For me, teaching you is one of the great joys of my life. I know you don't believe it, and I know it's one of the great tortures of yours, and I'm sorry. The world's like this. It's got some strange stuff. Nonetheless, this is the Wednesday, October 18th screencast, okay? And I talked about reviewing par nonlinear in the naive Bayes. Now, we looked at par nonlinear, okay, and we've reviewed it already. So we're going to look at the naive Bayes, and that's chapter 3 in the Data Smart text. And that's the Foreman text, the one with the guy, young guy with the beard, okay? And has Data Smart. He's upside down in the Data Smart titles, aren't it? It's by Wiley. He is the CIO of MailChimp. And as I've said before, I included this text to give you a taste of some of the issues we run into dealing with what we call big data and how we can use management science techniques to address some of those problems. And as you recall, when we did the very first case, that was the cluster analysis, we used Euclidean theory, geometry. Ooh, I know, it's scary, isn't it? To look at market segments or clusters revolving an offer that a wine company made, okay? And then we found out that when we went to 5 clusters, cutting it even finer, we didn't get much improvement. And I provided you all kinds of materials about that and explanations of the functions that are used in the Excel. I've got information for you about MailChimp, okay? Veroni diagrams, what they are. Concave versus convex functions and what that means versus linear trends, and then some economic models of nonlinear functions. And listen, you may say that's all gobbledygook. Listen, okay, I care enough about you not to underestimate you, and I care enough about you not to insult your intelligence by coming in here with anything except what is, as I best know, state-of-the-art information about management science and about big data and what's going on out there. And I take courses all the time to stay professional, to stay current, okay? And so you can be confident that what you're getting here is what's out there and what's state-of-the-art. And we're going to see that, you know, we can do some very significant things. So I'm going to dispense with the business about the par nonlinear and the cluster analysis, okay? Now, there is, in that case, was the use of the offset function and calculating the k-means clustering, okay? Okay, and that's information that talks to you about these statistical techniques that are used. Now, I'm going to have some people come in, you know, about 11 o'clock, if any of you do, and I'm starting early to do it and to have it there for you, i.e. this screencast. Well, that being said, okay, don't forget, and I'm going to just go through some particulars with you, naive Bayes, okay, is due on the 27th, okay? The single arbitrary is due on the 27th, okay? And I provided you some information there about the case for the resurrection of Jesus. We talked about that some, the mandrel basics, okay? naive bays, and types of air. Okay. And then here are all of those notes of mine that I put into PDF form, PDFs, and posted them so you can see what's going on. Okay. So let's roll again and find out what exactly is due, what's due, et cetera. And so we stay on target. Okay. First of all, I'm going to go up here to the syllabus part, syllabus section. Let's take a look. Okay. And we'll come over here. And all right, October 13th, you should have uploaded the cluster analysis and PAR nonlinear. What is today? My calendar says the 18th. Is there anything due on the, it's October 13th, October 14th, today is the 18th, the 17th, a couple of these were some special situation I had to deal with. Now, the next assignment's due, Naive Bayes, that's the mandrel, XLSX, and that's where we're gonna use Naive Bayesian theory, and then also single arbitrary, okay? And they are due on next Friday. So I'm gonna finish Naive Bayes out today, and then on Monday, finish out single arbitrary. Okay? So we will go from there. Now, this starts moving us into November, and you can see the stuff that's going to be due on November 3rd. So you'll want to take a look at this. But now, let's launch into Naive Bayes. Now, I want to remind you of this. I have not left you without a comforter. I'm teasing you. Okay. We'll go back over here to the modules. Okay. And we'll come down here. And the Naive Bayes is in the data text. The access to the files that he talks about there in page 36 in the Data Smart, okay, and the files are also over here in Canvas. Then I have all this information about PAR nonlinear, and then when we did the first case, okay, we did the cluster analysis, and I've got all kinds of information about that. All right. Now, as far as Naive Bayes and the mandrel basics, we've got that there. This is chapter 3 in the form and text, types of error, and app and the app tokens and those information. And I'm going to spend my time doing this. Is going to be this will be a little bit longer than usual, which is why I started 15 minutes early. And I want to talk about, first of all, the mandrel basics explained, okay? And I've got this here for you in a PDF, and I'm going to download it, okay? So we can see it. Okay, Naive Bayes is different from regular probability theorem in that it assumes joint probabilities, okay? Independence, which leads us to the multiplication rule. And this is called the chain rule of probability. You're going, oh no, it sounds like stat. I understand, okay? So if this is a scary part, okay, scroll through and take an aspirin. If not, hang in here with me. Because let me say this, probability is tough. It's just, at times, once we get past certain things, it's just not intuitive. I understand that greatly. I've gone through the disease of trying to deal with it myself, okay? It assumes joint probability, that is independence, and that leads us to the probability of A times B times C for whatever, This is the chain rule. And using Bayes, we create an artificial intelligence model. And in this one, we're saying the probability of an app, of word one being an app, word two, et cetera, and the probability that the word deals with something other than the app. And these are a set of tweets that are about, we have one set of tweets that's about the application that they're talking about here, and the other is, and others about anything else. And let me see if someone just checked in. I have a faithful warrior. Ah, Amanda, I've got a management science warrior. Welcome. I started a little bit early, so you'll want to catch it on the back end. What I intended to do, and I will go a little bit longer than usual. So, Amanda, if you were planning on bugging out to, you know, take off or fall or whatever, or you have a class, whatever, it's okay. You can always come back and pick up the front end and then the back end of the screencast, because there's a lot here, and I want to go through it, and I feel I need to. So I'm being a little more didactic than I normally am. So part of the, and remember, as we talked about management science, okay, we utilize models. Just like in cluster analysis, we use the Euclidean model. Here in this case, in Mandrel, we're working with probability theorem, okay? And we talk about, and then we talk about the decision rule, and I'm really summarizing for everybody what's in the text. This is the maximum a priori rule, okay? And we calculate it. And as I mentioned here in point number four, you assume the odds are 50-50 that a tweet is about the app versus that the tweet is about something else. Remember, we have two sets of tweets, okay? And we assume that there's a 50-50 chance, okay, that the tweet is about the app or that it's not. Now, a classical mathematician, like my colleagues over in math, would absolutely come unglued, because they'd say, no, you can't assume that. But we use naive Bayes, and we call it naive Bayes because we make this very naive assumption, because we don't always know the a priori. We don't know the probabilities going in. Okay, so Bayes, as he worked through problems, came to the realization that, you know, a lot of times we're dealing with things that we don't know the a priori, we don't know the probability, okay, and that it's foolish for us to build a model that assumes. So he says, let's just go ahead and be naive and assume that it's 50-50. Okay. This is important because, as again, as we talk about in this management science course, management science is about problem solving that leads us to decision making. And the foundation of it is that we find a model that we apply to a problem. Doing so disciplines us in our approach. I think I mentioned this yesterday to the data admin class, and I'll mention to you, I read an article, it was over in the New York Times, and it startled me, because they said if on average all of the delivery trucks, I think it was for UPS, are off a mile a year in terms of their deliveries, they waste 50 million gallons of gasoline. That's incredible to me. Okay. And that's a lot of carbons. And that's a lot to throw into the atmosphere. So they use extreme precision with GPS to make sure that their deliveries are absolutely pinpoint accurate. And GPS, global positioning system, okay, it is not the same as GIS. You'll hear people use those terms. GIS is geographic information system, where I take geographic data and I apply it to a particular setting or situation. Global positioning, okay, is literally where there's about a trillion or so spots on the earth, where we just put a marker and said, okay, and we divided all the surface area of the Earth up. Now, we have not, we're still doing mapping. We have satellites out there. And this past year, we have about 90% of the elevations on planet Earth mapped. All that being said is, again, we're using a model. Now, here we're going to use adaptive smoothing. When you took STAT, okay, I pray that you did some predictive modeling. If you took BTEC 1123, BISS 1123 with me, you went through, okay, we had a case where we used the linear regression, okay? Now, you can continue on what we call a naive forecast and say, well, it grew 3% last year, my portfolio, so it'll just keep growing 3%, okay? We all know that's ridiculous. Then there's what we call adaptive forecasting, where we use what we call a smoothing constant, okay, to smooth so that the smoothing constant is intended to take the noise out of data. All data have two things, signal and noise. Signal, random variation effects, and noise. Signal meaning the real data, pardon me, and then noise, just noise that's built into them. Okay, and so we're going to use adaptive smoothing, where we assume that the probability that a word is about the app, okay, word one, and we have the probability of word two that it's an app is greater than or equal to, right here, the probability that word one is about something other than the app, and that word two is about something other than the app. And then we convert the products for the app and for the other. We're going to take these adaptive smoothing data, and we're going to convert them to logarithms. Logarithms, okay, and that's when we convert numbers to logs. You're going, oh, my ears are hurting. I understand. Okay, I love math. My problem is math doesn't love me. I'm not that good at it. If I was, I'd be teaching mathematics, because I think it's beautiful. But okay, and that's my own personality flaw, and I'm sorry I shared. But again, we convert them to logs because logarithms show us the reality of what a number really is. Now, there are some functions that are used in the case, and I'm and you'll see these. And let me see who else did I. What other warrior have I got? Oh, I've got Alexander. He's also another management science warrior. Welcome. And you'll want to catch on the front end. I started about 15 minutes early, Alexander. So you'll want to double back, okay? And I want to go through this because, as I said when I started this screencast, I never underestimate you young people, okay? And unfortunately, you've grown up in a period of time where you've probably been grossly underestimated in terms of your intelligence and your character and what you can do. And I never do that. I think you're all so awesome and bright. You can do fantastic things. You just need somebody to tell you you can do it and give you the tools, and you'll go do it. So that's why I'm going through this, so you can see a cutting edge problem in management science. That's why I'm using this textbook. Well, here are the Excel functions, and we're going to use the lower, the substitute. A lot of these, okay, are what we do and today when we work with what we call big data or unstructured data like tweets, is we clean them up before we try to process them. Okay. Now, well, here all the Excel functions are used in the case. And you can see they are text oriented and more database oriented. Okay. And the reason I think this guy Foreman, he's just a genius, because he took these very simple, fairly unsophisticated functions, put them together, and has this marvelous little machine he created. Now, again, MailChimp, as you know, as I've shared with you, here's some more of these, the land, the mid, this is, and here's where we find the natural logarithm of a number. And I walk you through about what that, you know, the natural logarithm based on the constant. You're going, my head hurts. Okay, I understand. And so we convert each real number to a, and I've got a link for you to wolfram.com to give you the best explanation. Okay. And the point of this is not to make you geeks, but to get your attention to understand that while you say, this is just the most boring thing, I should be eating ice cream on my way home. Your counterparts in China are gobbling this stuff up. And I'll tell you why. They see how you and I live, and they want to live like you and I. They see nice cars, nice houses, cool-looking clothes, phones, etc. And they say, we want that too. Now, the Chinese, that culture's been around 12,000 years. So to them, we're just punks, okay? And they, you know, the Chinese, the United States, to let everybody know we're around and we're the big dog on the block, we send out aircraft carriers, okay, all over the world. And people see an aircraft carrier in the United States government, and they go, oh, okay, that's a lot of firepower, and it is. The Chinese say, we'll do something a little more subtle, maybe even more important. We're just going to go in the middle of the China Ocean and build an island. And so they created an island and said, hey, this is China too. Okay, that shows you their thought processes and how that culture, layered with all kinds of stuff, is so important. And they gobble this stuff up because they understand the world, the global marketplace, is so competitive that the only people who win are those who outthink their competitors. You can't outspend people. You can't out-advertise them. It really does boil down to that, okay? And I've told you the story about, probably you've heard it, and here's a lesson for you about Steve Jobs. When Jobs was, his first time around, is when he founded Apple and then took it public, they fired him. His board ran him off. So he said, well, I need something to do. So he went into the movie business and created a company we've all heard of called Pixar. So he revolutionized the movie business. If you don't believe me, look at the list of movies and see how many of them have extreme animation, most of it based on stuff developed at Pixar. Now, when he was asked to return when Apple was going bankrupt, this guy who's renowned for his design capabilities, okay, came back and he became a world expert on supply chains and manufacturing processes, because he said, I've got some ideas for some products that are going to sell like hotcakes, but I've got to be able to get them made and delivered to people. And so he did. And so that became his thing. And so that should be a lesson for us. Well, that being said, here are the other functions that are built into Excel. Okay. And then I want to walk you through, and this is a summary of what's going to go on. Then we'll take a look some more at the tabs. But there's a certain part of me that says, I think it'd be a good idea for you when you open up the Mandrel file, and it's over there in the files, and we'll talk about that. We'll get through the tabs. Again, all of you who've joined, I started about 15 minutes early. I will probably go 15 or 20 minutes late because this is worth its time. So what I would do is this. When the 15 minutes is up for you, if you need to leave, I won't be offended or hurt or angry or count you off or anything like that. I use the screencast for two reasons. One, to make this convenient for you, especially those of you who are athletes or your work. But number two, so I can cover the material in the depth which it deserves And then you can chunk it. You can watch a bit. And I would recommend this to you. Watch about 10 or 15 minutes, stop, and you can keep notes on a bit. Okay? So in the test prediction tab, we're going to compare. We'll find a tab in there. And what we're doing is we're comparing tweets that we say are about the app versus tweets that are classified as something else. And so we've got these tweets we've collected. We're trying to determine, is this about our product or not? And then I give you the numbering, okay, and the class and the prediction and a conditional statement. And again, we use naive Bayes, assuming, okay, independent events, okay, in terms of the joint probabilities, okay? And we assume a conditional probability. We started with 50-50, and then we just made an assumption. And this is the whole reason he calls it naive Bayes, for a very simple reason. Classic probability theorem says you build probabilities on the basis of a priori, prior knowledge. Naive Bayes says, no, I don't know. And one, I don't know if I posted it here or not, but when that airliner just disappeared, okay, people said, there were a lot of the people who were involved in searching the area. They identified the area. They know where the plane went down. They don't know exactly where the plane is at because the black boxes stopped beeping. Now you say, well, how do they know the area? Well, they know the area because they're starting to see pieces of things wash up on the shores there in East Africa, on the shores of East Africa. And knowing currents and wind and all of that, they know that that's where the plane went down. They just can't find it. Because you're talking about a million or two square miles of water. That's the huge amount of water in the oceans is just incredible, which is why most flights, consumer flights, are at night, because they don't want you to look down and see nothing but water and panic. Because when they first started flying commercial flights, they'd fly in the daytime. People look down and see nothing but water and they panic. Okay, so they do most of them at night. If you do an international and you're flying over a lot of land, why, you know, that's a different story. Well, let's walk you through, okay, the remaining statements of how that's all put together and how we're doing the test, okay? And I'll walk you through all of those, okay? So I don't know how else really to grasp it. Now, what I've done is if I were you, I'd have, if you can get a multi-screen experience going, I'd have this open along with the spreadsheet, okay? And that, you know, there's a lot going on. Well, I'm going to close this off, okay? And I'm going to go back to the files section, okay? We'll return here. And let's find Mandrill. And that's going to be here in the Foreman files. Okay, and here are the Foreman's files. That's from the DataSmart. And we're going to download that. And we'll see Mandrill by itself. Now, I'm going to give this kind of a once-over treatment today for a very simple reason. There's a lot to digest, okay? And I understand. One of the reasons I'll have the thing there so you can just post it, get the credit, is because I think if you take the time, okay, to go back and look and walk through the process with the book chapter, with my notes, with the file, you'll really get the depth of it, okay? And I can tell you, I look at this case every time I teach this course, I go, there's so much in here, okay? And when I can take a set of tweets, strip them bare, then count them and analyze them and come up with about an 85 or 90% probability score using this method, I'd say, hey, I'm good to go. Now, one of the things we're doing here, and I didn't mention this, is we're using this is management science, okay? And we're using a research model. And that model is called ex post facto, E-X-P-O-S-T-F-A-C-T-O, after the fact. When somebody dies in a hospital, the hospital will have a post-mortem. That's ex post facto data. We learn a lot when we collect data after an event has occurred to try to figure out, well, what were the causes? Geologists do this a whole lot when they try to study volcanoes and earthquakes. Meteorologists do this. All the hard people in hard sciences do a lot of ex post facto because stuff in nature doesn't happen all the time. And for us, when we're trying to build, for the people at MailChimp, when they're trying to build a filter, you know, for emails, and I've got a file in there for it shows you how much spam costs us, then an ex post facto model is very appropriate. Okay, so that's what's going on. Well, let's open up the file here. Okay, and here's the Mandrel, and we're going to open it up. Okay. Now I want to say this: this guy Foreman, who's the author of your textbook, he's probably, if he's 15 years older than most of you, I'd be surprised. He's a very young man, but he's bright. He's so bright, he's scary. So here's the very first. This is basically in this first app, and what we did here is he just cleaned this thing up. Got rid of the extraneous stuff using the substitute. We only use the lower, okay, and then the substitute to strip it down, okay, and then to get I, which is the stripped down version of the tweet, okay. And we'll look over this here for just a minute. So that's the cleaned up tweet. Okay, now we know that these 150 tweets are about the application. Okay, now we have a set that are about something else. And we have to go through the same process. Okay, a simple example of a postmortem. Well, an extreme example, a plane crash. When a plane crashes, you know, the United States National Safety and Transportation Board sends a team of people out to start to figure out what happened, okay? And so they're using naive Bayes. Now, classical mathematicians don't like it. They hate it, but it works pretty well. Okay, and I think there's a book. There are a couple of books over there I would recommend on understanding. But you can read this chapter 3 of this book, and you'll see it. Okay, so we're cleaning these up. We come over here to I, and we've got our whole tweet. Okay, and so we have 150 that are about the application, 150 that are not. 150 tweets that say, this product or service is fabulous or good. 150 that say it's awful, okay? So that's what's going on. Now, once we've done this, okay, once we've cleaned these data up, now we can process them. This is part of when you're gonna hear people talk about big data, most of the work is getting the data into a format where I can work with it, okay? And now we're gonna count, and once we do this, we have some app tokens, okay? Now, here's the tweet, cleaned up. Here's the space position. So what we're gonna do is we're going to go through these and get the length on that token, okay? And I have a handout. I have a handout there. It's in PDF form that explains exactly what's going on in terms of the app token. Now, here's a token. Here's space position zero. Okay. And we use the if error statement to analyze the length. Okay. And it's going to give us the length of that token that's of relevance. Okay. Now, the whole point here, okay, is to make sure that we're working with, you know, something that's countable, and so we give it some distances. We calculate the size of it, okay? And here we're using the if error statement. And if you want to, it's probably a good idea to follow along in the textbook, okay? And you'll see over there where he talks about the app tokens, okay? And how we're calculating that, okay? So the column H gives us, you know, the prep to data, and that's length of 7, okay, and the length of C26, okay, that's, and we'll click on that, and it gives us the length of the text, okay, and so we're looking at app tokens, and we'll come down here, we start at space 0, and we go through the same conditional statement. Okay. And do we find, and we give a value if there's an error. And then we get the length. And we walk through that. And what we're doing there is we're splitting the state, we're splitting up the spaces. Okay, so we're doing some more additional cleaning with these data. We've gotten some of the extraneous stuff out, and now we're working down to a length. Okay, and he talks about this over there in page 88 and 89. Okay, and what we're doing is we're counting how many times a word is used in all of the apps. Okay, how many times is it used in all the tweets in a category? So we have to, so, and we had limited ourselves to 30 words per tweet, okay, 30 characters per tweet or 30 words, or we'll call them tokens. And you can see as you scroll down here, this is why you have 150 times 30, which is 4,500. Okay, and so we go through that process of getting that, if there's an error, and we get what the value is, and so the token is blog, and we know, for example, that it occurs 6 times. The token, on the app tokens, we have that we have a 6, and we always start at the 0. Now watch, as we come down here on this space position, watch what's going to happen. Okay, now you'll see that we started at position 7. You can see we've done 0, we got, and we started the first length up there was 6, now we're at 7. And you'll see that starts to change as we count the number of times that a particular token appears. That's why we have the 4,500. And we just basically do the same thing with the other tokens. And there's the token, and we get the links. Now what we're doing is we're cleaning these up, and we're counting these tokens. We've said, okay, once they're cleaned up, and it's a unit of what we call a unit of measure, we have a token. Okay? Now, I know this is like drinking water out of a fire hydrant. Listen, I teach this course, and this is the, I guess, the second or third time, maybe the fourth, that I've used this text since I discovered it was out there, and I saw how valuable it was. And I can tell you, I have to kind of work my brain through it every single time. Okay? Now, if you did this with repetition, what's so smart here is the guy put this together. That's why he's called it. So the book's called Data Smart. It probably should be called The Guy Smart, because he is a brilliant human being to put this together. Well, we've got the link on these apps. And you can see we started Space Position Zero. We got 4,500 of the other. And we're doing what we call a textual analysis. And you'll notice here we come to a point where we get out of zero, we get to four. And then the position of that, and then the length of that app, we go from zero, and then we come to position four. We're just going through each position within those tweets to get the number of times that particular token shows up. Okay? Because this lets us start to attribute semantics or meaning to these words. Look, if you were writing an article about Donald Trump and the word Trump never came up, I'd say, who are you writing about? That's really all that's going on here. There's just a whole lot of cleaning up data, counting spaces and characters, etc. And there in chapter 3, he walks you through all of that, as well as the different Excel functions, okay, and that really is what's going well. Once he's done that, okay, and now we're over here into the app token probabilities, and he starts talking about that over on page 92. And he says, okay, what are the probabilities that a given token shows up? Okay, and so we're going to count them. Okay, and we're going to get the probability, and then we're going to take that probability and convert it, okay, to a logarithm. Yeah, let's see what do you mean? Well, we're using a pivot table. I think he uses a pivot. Yeah, uses a pivot table here to get that accomplished. And he shows you the pivot table over there, the builder over on page 92. And you've all seen pivot tables. As I've said before, they're the most powerful tool in Excel outside of Optimizer. Here we add one to everything. This is just to make sure that this is part of that adaptive smoothing process. We add one to each of them, okay? And this is the tokens and how many times they occurred. And if you scroll down, you'll see. And you see, so, wow, a lot of these are just one, but some of these are 10, 36, 11. Ah, okie dokie. Now we add one to everything to make it, to smooth it. Okay, and that's, and as long as we do that, okay, as long as we do that, we're good, because we're treating those data uniformly. Now we get the probability of the token. You say, whoa, okay, what do we do? Well, here we have C5 over C828. And 828, so all the way down here. And that gives us a probability of occurrence. Well, as you can see, we have some really, really tiny probabilities here. Now, he talks a little bit about Excel and its ability to handle the number of digits to the right. And he is correct. It's got some limitations. So one of the ways we deal with that is we take these probabilities, okay, these and we convert them using the linear. okay? And the natural logarithm of a number. And so we convert them to logs. We turn them into logarithmic data. That are logarithmic data are called natural data. They're as close to ratio-based data as we can get. And you're going, oh no, this sounds like stat again. I'm sorry. Okay. Here's the deal. In stat, they should have told you, whoever they are, there are these types of numbers. Ratio that have absolute zero. Okay. And I'm going through the order in terms of higher to lower. Interval, equally divisible on an infinite basis. Okay. Then ordinal, greater than, lesser than, higher, lower, faster, slower, and then nominal or categorical counts, okay? So what we've done is we've taken these probabilities that are interval data, okay, and we use the natural log function in Excel to make them logarithmic. So we can work with them a lot easier. It's just easier to work with them because these decimal points get so meaningless. And we're converting them. That's not a big deal. Think of it like this. I have something I'm working with, and I use a microscope to see it. It's still there. It's just the microscope helps me see it. So think of it like that. So we've got these probabilities converted, okay, of all of these items in terms of their length. What are the probabilities that occur? We just divided that length by the total numbers to come up with that probability. Now again, this is naive Bayes because we're assuming independent probabilities. Now you know that when you assume dependent probabilities, in other words, event B is dependent upon A, probability theorem gets exceptionally tricky. And you had your stat course and you probably were tearing your hair out when you were working with dependent probabilities, okay? And it can make you want to go nutty. I understand, okay? Like I told you, I love math. Math doesn't love me. And you know, for example, last night I was watching the playoff game. I watched the two playoff games. I'm a baseball freak. And my dream in life was to be a catcher for the New York Yankees. And you know what foiled me, stopped me? Here's the irony of it. I wanted to play a catcher, the position of catcher, the guy that catches the ball. But my arm wasn't strong enough to throw to second base fast enough to please the people who came out and looked at me. So my heart was broken for about 2 years. Okay, I could hit the ball, I could field pretty well, I could handle, you know, the hammering that a catcher takes. You know, someone throwing something at 100 miles, look, go get a catcher's mitt, let someone throw bricks at you 100 miles an hour and see what happens. Well, you understand why they go out there. I'm surprised I don't have full armor. Catcher is a job that takes a lot of courage, as far as I'm concerned. You have a large angry man in front of you with a bat, or someone who's throwing that bat around, you get whacked. But you see, my arm didn't love me. So I watch saying, what could have been? Instead, I'm here torturing you this morning. And for that, pray for my death. It's not going to work. You prayed, it's not working. So we get the probabilities of the apps. Now we're going to compute the probabilities of the others. Let's go back here for a moment and take a look. Now, look at the natural logarithm number here, which is higher consistently than these that are not about the app. Now, again, we're doing an ex post facto study where we took 150 tweets about the product and 150. We're building a predictive model, okay? Give you an example, heart attacks. Well, how do they know a certain number of people, how do they know the risk? Well, the way that they find out that your risk for heart attack is over the years, the medical profession and medical researchers have studied, well, did they smoke? Did they have stress? How were they overweight? Did they eat certain foods, et cetera? Okay. and they die, you know, they die of a heart attack. I've told all of you, I had a father who smoked Lucky Strikes unfiltered all of his life up to the last, before he died 3 years before. He never died, he didn't die of cancer. He died of a heart attack. Although all of his life he was as skinny as a rail. You wouldn't know it looking at me. I've got more of my mother's girth, if you will. But I have another relative who smoked for 45 years. And when she had heart trouble, the doctor told her, I can't operate on you until you've been off cigarettes for 3 years. Because otherwise, if I put you under, you're probably going to die. So that we know, the ex post facto studies help us. And so we've got these other token probabilities to look, see they're lower. Why? Well, because they're not about the app. Okay, now we do some test tweets. Now this is where he does the tests, okay? And he's gonna do a prediction, and I say, again, let me just salute you. I wanna say, I proclaim Amanda, Suzanne, and Alexander, I proclaim you management science warriors. This is like Star Wars, you know, where Yoda kind of said, I proclaim you a war. You're management science warriors. And I think you ought to go get yourself some t-shirts made that say, I'm a management science warrior, and wear it around campus. Well, you know, whatever. You know, I've probably done this too long. I'm probably babbling. Okay. We've got the test tweets. Okay. And so we've got, you know, 20. And notice what we got going on. We've got 10 of them that are about the app. And we've got 10 of them that are not. And we're going to test them. And this is where we're going to test our predictive ability. Okay. When MailChimp sells their products to people, it's got to be able to predict this is spam, this is junk. Now, your OBU email, for example, has some filtering capabilities, but normally the filter that does it is you, and you're just like me. Well, I'll tell you what, you get emails from me, you put them in delete. I know that. You don't read them. And some of you have missed, you know, your opportunity to win $1 million. I'm kidding you. Anyway, here's a tweet, okay, that we know is about the app. And here we begin to clean it up. Ah, the same thing. Yeah. And then we end up with the token. We do the same thing with the other. Those that are about, we know that are about the other, and we clean them up. And so we've got our test bin now. We've got our test. We had computed probabilities. And so far, the natural logarithmic numbers are telling me, yeah, these are different. Here are the test tweets, and then here's the test predictions. Now, I want to walk you through this for just a minute. Here are those about the app. Okay. And here are each of the words. Okay. And then we get the sum of the conditional probabilities for number one. Because we get the conditional probability for each token. Okay, and we get that sum. Same here. Now we know which ones are other and which ones are not. All right. And here's where we've made our predictions using this conditional statement. If C25 is greater than C48, it's app. If not, it's other. Same thing here. And you'll notice that we had 20 of them, and we correctly predicted if it was an app or the other 19 out of 20 times. That ain't bad. That's pretty, pretty good. Okay? 95%. Not bad. Now, MailChimp does this And they'll probably take, when they have a client, their clients, they probably take thousands of these and run. And look, they have a proprietary model that they use. This guy just wrote the book and showed us kind of on a baby system or baby way how this works. Okay. So, you know, there's a little bit more that goes in, and they use bots that have a lot higher degrees of precision. But you can see we do that conditional statement and we check. And 19 out of 20 is not bad. Okay. Most of you, if you take a test, you make a 95, you go, oh, okay, that's not bad. So we compared those probabilities versus the other. And there are our test predictions and versus our test tweets. So this is not bad. Now, you know, when I have about a 95% degree accuracy rate, particularly with stuff out in the real world, okay, I'm in good shape. And let me give you a real interesting example, okay, since I've wasted a lot of your morning already. Why not waste the whole morning? I know, I understand. Speeds on the speed limits on highways, okay? In most highways in the United States, it's 70 miles an hour out on the interstate. Now, there are some interstates where it's 80 and 85. Nevada has, I think it's 80 or 85 in Nevada, or Nevada, however you pronounce it. Arizona has, is it Arizona? I think it's, or New Mexico. I think it's Arizona, that there are some stretches of the interstate where it's 80 miles an hour. Nevada, because it has such huge distances, is always been, you know, one of those. And the biggest speeding ticket I ever got, I'll just tell you, I was with my sis and her husband, and he was working for a corporation, and we drove to Las Vegas, and he had a very, very nice vehicle. And so he said, well, take the wheel and let's just see what this thing will do. And, you know, I was clocked at 111. I'm 111. And let me tell you something. 111 miles an hour on straight, dry highway. And I kept thinking, this thing feels real mushy. I got a ticket, to say the least. Okay, so I'm a criminal speeder. What can I say? So next time you go watch, you know, Gone in 60 Seconds, it's Dr. Harmon's favorite movie. It's really not, but yes, I did. That was a big ticket, 111 miles an hour. Of course, my brother-in-law helped pay for it. So when people are out there going 200 miles an hour in those cars, I said, those are extremely gifted people. And again, you know me, I'm kind of a smart aleck. And I said, what are the chances that you were going to catch me? And he said, oh, about 90%. I said, how do you know? He said, because people come on this stretch of road, highway, and they love to see how fast their car will go. And he said, the state of Nevada makes a lot of money off this stretch of road. And I thought, okay, I learned my lesson there. But it was 111. It was a nice vehicle. One of those big ones, you know, back when the car was a car, not these wimpy little things they sell to us now. And 111 is fast. It's fast. It's the fastest I've ever driven a car in my life and whatever. And it was a pretty steep fine. Well, that being said, now you understand all about probabilities, and you see how you took these tweets. We converted them over to tokens. We counted the tokens. We looked at their probability of occurrence. We saw using natural logarithms that those tweets that were about the app were larger than those that were not. Then we took some test tweets. We took 20 that we knew. We took 20 tweets, 10 that we knew were about the app, 10 that we knew were not about the app. And then we did our predictive model. And guess what? We came out smelling like a rose, 95%. Okay? This brings me to the final point I'm going to make about this case. And it's here for you. All you got to do for credit for Mandrill, upload it. Okay. Because here's what I think: you're smart enough to say, this is kind of interesting. I'll go back and take a look at that. Okay. And I'm not going to grade. I'm not going to go through these and grade these and see if you got them right. You said, Dr. Harmon, there's no way I could put this together. I know that. And your punishment is having to listen to me. And so, you know, life's full of trade-offs. Okay. But again, what we've done here is we've built a nice predictive model. And out in the real world, if you're batting 95%, you're doing pretty good. And so there's so much in this case. Okay. But it is a classic management science problem dealing with occurrence and how we can use the naive Bayes for doing prediction. And chapter 3, he walks you through all of the every single little detail about the classification. Okay. And talks about that. Now, I would recommend that if you get the chance, that you read chapter 4, okay? Other than what's in your textbook, which is the gold standard textbook in management science, I have never seen anybody in chapter 4, in chapter 4 takes this notion of optimization and really helps us understand why it's so important, why it's so critical, and how what a fantastic tool it is. Okay? Chapter 4 in this textbook is it's gold. And again, you're going into the most competitive workplace job market in the world, in the history of the world. You're going to be business professionals in the most competitive environment ever in history. So you have to be armed properly, and you have to be ready for it. And this is how you get ready. Okay. And my belief is that although you may never use an optimization model, if you understand that, okay, you'll be a much better business professional. Well, that pretty much does it. Okay, I'm going to close this off here, and again, you can upload that. And I'm not going to save any changes I made, so you'll want to upload that file for the credit. And since I've been so crazy about this, talking about Bayes, I'm going to take you over and show you a book, recommend a book to you. You say, oh, this is stupid. I know, but there will be the one or two of you, or maybe five of you, or maybe all of you who'll go, man, I'd like to learn a little bit more about this. So I'm going to find this. Now I find you the book that I would recommend that you take a look at. I want to find that textbook. Where's that thing at? Probably did the wrong search. Hang on here with me. All right, let me just do this. Probability. Oh, I have to go back and look it up, but I've had it for several years, and I really would recommend it. That makes me crazy. Well, I'll find it next time and show it to you. Okay. Anyway, my friends, you know, again, let's go back over. You'll want to upload the Mandrill file. Okay. And so here's what's due back down here. And so you know what's going on. And on, let's see, the 27th. Now, ice cold should have already been done. That's yeah. And then that's due the 6th. that was due the 6th. Okay, yeah. Okay, I had to make a couple of. Here it is. Upload Mandrill, and then single arbitrary. Now next week, that's due the 27th. Next week we'll talk about single arbitrary, about that case, and when we move back into a little bit into the textbook. Okay, listen, please be careful if you're headed home, and have a great free fall days. Thank you for the four of you who are here, and I know there'll be others who will listen later on, etc. And we did go a little bit later, so this is about 100 and some odd minutes. This is an hour and 15 minutes or so, so 75 some odd minutes. Okay, thank you very much, and I look forward to seeing all of you next week. Enjoy your fall free days.